I'm going to give it a try to introduce a remarkable person to you. A long, long, long time ago, somewhere in the 1920s or 1930s, it was really a long time ago, he studied at CEPT. After he studied at CEPT, he went to study in Harvard and he graduated in 1987. He goes now between Mumbai and the United States. He travels a lot. He's an absolutely rock star. He worked with the Urban Design Research Institute in Mumbai, and he's a very loyal person. Because somewhere in the 1920s and the 30s, he keeps on coming back to CEPT, and he starts now designing buildings for us. Please welcome the initiator of the Z-axis, Rahul Mehrotra.
Thank you very much. Is this working? This is okay? Yes. Okay. Thanks, Anne. Thank you, Anne, for those, I think, kind words. I wasn't sure, and I think you live in a different century than I do, for sure. So, but anyway, thank you very much. Particular thanks to Bimal, to Anne, and to Henk, and everyone from ARCHIPRIX for this invitation to speak, which is an absolute honor. I can't tell you, speaking here at CEPT and speaking at ARCHIPRIX is a double honor. So thank you very much. To speak to students of the next generation is always difficult for two reasons. I know there are others who are not students, but I think a lot of what I'm going to say, I'm thinking about students. And the first is, when you speak to younger people, you hope to make sense, because the world is changing so fast that the medium of communication, the culture of communication, is so different that always one is anxious, is one communicating clearly. And the second is bigger, which is the anxiety of balancing hope for your futures with the reality that surrounds us. And the reality everywhere is becoming harder and harder to comprehend. Peter Turchin, who's a professor at the University of Connecticut's Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology, warned in an article which was published just 6 weeks ago that society globally could risk implosion within this next decade. And he's predicted that by 2020, we are not going to know society the way we know it today. He's going to talk, he expects there to be many years of political turmoil, some of which we are already seeing, peaking in the 2020s, he says specifically. And what he sort of also clarifies is that this is a science-based forecast. It's not a prophecy. It's based on solid social science. Turchin is a leader in cleodynamics, which is an interdisciplinary field of study that sees historical events such as the collapse of empires as following predictable mathematical models based on historical data. The professor has tracked 40 factors in society that include such aspects as wealth inequity, stagnating well-being, growing political fragmentation, and governmental dysfunctionalism. So this is a very scientific prediction that he's made. And I read this just 6 weeks ago, and it completely blew my mind. He said the key to this sort of battle that is going to occur in society, the main reason that he sort of puts there is what he calls elite overproduction. He said we are producing too many elite, and there's an overproduction of the elite, in which the number of rich grow larger while the majority of society grapples with a stagnant standard of living, poor fiscal health, and many other factors like that, he believes. He says the upper classes too will be ripped apart by bitter competition, with a population of capable but angry elite wannabe who will be shut out of power by the older elite. Now, this is his prediction. And that fissure will undermine the spirit of cooperation and cause society to fragment further, is what he predicts. This is interesting. You see patterns of this, if you think about it, all over the world. You have political boundaries being made, remade in the Middle East, for example. And so a search for identity among the swell of anonymous forces from globalization to technology, because a combination of globalization and technology is partly what's refiguring this landscape as we've known it, will drive, he believes, political upheaval. But it's all not bad news. Naturally, it should not be. Because the awareness of our problems could help us stop them before we pitch over the edge. The descent is not inevitable, he writes. Perhaps we can avoid the worst. Perhaps by switching to a less harrowing track. Perhaps by redesigning the roller coaster altogether. And I think this is where there is the agency of design. Design becomes very important. I'm not saying architecture, urban planning will solve the problems, but by recognizing these problems, I think we can contribute to these solutions. Because I think this is the terrible reality of our contemporary times. And what I mean by this is, how can we take on this reality and still have hope? Hope for another generation. Because for us as architects, the way we contribute to the world around us is reimagining these spatial possibilities. So whether it's the creation of more wealth so it can be finally distributed, whether it's the issue of inequity, I think spatial arrangements have a big role to play. And I personally have great hope for the profession, because in the profession, and in the profession in its present configuration, so I don't want to escape that reality of being, of questioning what an architect means. I mean, I know we have that discussion in the profession. I'm also aware of the fact that we, in our present configuration as professions, are being perceived also as part of that elite that I was talking about. We must interrogate this critically, but we must also be careful not to romanticize what this means for society. We often hear arguments for redefining the role of the architect, not even using the term architect. I personally think this reinvention comes not from the reinvention of the individual architect, but reinventing our institutions, transforming transforming the very sort of structures of these institutions and what they stand for. And that's why gatherings like this, the University of SEPT, ARCHIPRIX, these are incredibly important forum if we have to make this sort of reinvention. So it is the re-energizing and the reformulation of our institutions, both professional, educational, is where we can make this systemic change. Otherwise, you'll just have merely a new avatar of a kind of prima donna architect or elite architect, perhaps called something else. So in my attempt to make a balance between hope for us as architects and yet share with you my readings of this contemporary reality, I'm going to divide this next 50 minutes or an hour into two parts. In the first, I'll share these readings with you of how at least I read what's around us and how it's important for us to continuously negotiate between this larger picture and the locality of our arrangements and of our engagements. And in the second half, I will show you a few projects where we've struggled with these issues. And I think finally, it's really the question of the agency of design. How can we finally act? And while I'm going to focus on India, I hope for all our guests from around the world, this resonates in some way. So this was someone from the World Bank, but I thought it was very important because clearly, if we accept that we are in this crisis, it's really a terrible thing to waste, because crises often are incredible opportunities to reinvent what we are doing. Today in India, the state has more or less given up in this responsibility of projecting India through the built environment and the physical environment as it had done in the past, in the post-independence era, for example, with several state capitals, institution buildings, etc. That's again a space that needs to be reclaimed. Today, the major state-directed projects are highways, flyovers, airports, telecommunication networks, electricity grids, which connect urban centers, but don't contribute to determining and guiding their physical sort of structure. In India's post-liberalization economy, private capital chooses to build environments that are insulated from the context, because the context for us as architects is very operative, without the burdens in these cases of facilitating citizenship or placemaking necessary to create a real city. So these become gated communities which take on the form of vertical towers, as you see in this image, in the inner city and sprawling suburban compounds on the periphery. In fact, in the state-controlled economy, the physical relationship between different classes was often orchestrated according to a master plan. Not always successful, but that was the socialist sort of model. Today, I think, in those cases, entitlement, housing, jobs, there was at least some attempt to orchestrate this. In the new economy, there's a fragmentation of services and production locations, which has resulted in a kind of bazaar-like urbanism, which has woven its presence through the entire landscape. And that was that bazaar-like urbanism which all these workshops we had here in the last week or 10 days were engaging with, trying to create these micro-narratives within the megacity about this bazaar-like urbanism, which is fragmented and fractured. So in the process of these transformations in the urban landscape, perhaps the role and influence of the professional architect has been marginalized. Just like these communities secede from the city, have we been seceded from society? Because within conventional practice, the professional does not engage with the broader landscape, but rather chooses to operate within the specificities of a particular site, and therefore becomes disconnected in some ways with what I believe is the larger context of our practice. So in trying to understand this condition, one of the major disruptions clearly is global capital and technology, the combination of the two. And global capital creates immense fragmentation. So while it has a homogenizing effect, so to speak, it also has a heterogenizing effect, which fractures, and it actually reinforces differences. And this is leading to an absolute stunning level of inequity on this entire planet, which is manifest in the physical form of these places. This I call the architecture and cities of global capital, of impatient capital, because capital inherently is impatient. And this is very important to recognize, because then time becomes incredibly important. Vendors drive the production of architecture. And so the architect's role is a little bit of acrobatics here and there, but it's all about image making for global capital. And this is interesting and important to recognize. But capital also becomes patient when it resides in universities like this, when it resides in foundations. By the time it gets to the government, sometimes it becomes too patient. And so then we become impatient as architects to even get anything done. But so this is important where capital resides, because that determines the pace at which it can act. And on the other hand, capital, on account of its impatience, creates architecture and urban form that's often whimsical, often vendor-driven, like I said, for the ease of construction and the speed of construction. And from that actually emerge new roles for architects. So the roles of the architect then is about becoming the interface between technology and the building processes, et cetera. Society doesn't enter that equation as mindfully as it should, and it heightens the idea of the architect and the architecture that is produced as an autonomous sort of object. Furthermore, designers, in their attempt to understand the world, we divide this into binaries. And even the question of equity, inequity versus equity is a binary that we set up. And of course, inequity as a phenomena has, it's completely a direct relationship to form, because this is the kind of extreme that you get. And in our cities in India, they begin to coexist in the way we see in that image. But in this attempt for designers to understand the world, we organize it as binaries. We tend to organize these as, they're productive categories to describe the world, but they're totally unproductive categories to act as designers. And they're, in my belief, and that's my thesis, they're completely useless for us to actually intervene finally, to act on it. We can understand the world through them, but we cannot construct the world through them. And so here for me it was interesting to see these workshops, because it was about these micro-narratives in the megacity. They were in very interesting themes, the hybrid use of spaces, forgotten voices. These are all the micro-narratives that were being culled to understand the megacity, tactics of bricolage, the city positive, the water for the city, vacant land. I mean, there were a number of themes that were very interesting. But I think the question that ran through my mind is, and I kept thinking about that after every presentation, is how do you fold this back into then the meta-narrative, which makes the megacity. And so this is, I think, for the students who engaged in the workshop, a very important question to go away with. Because if you make the description of the micro-narrative an end in itself, you might as well study sociology, you might as well study many, many aspects and disciplines of the liberal arts, which is to say that It is about observation. Architecture is very much about intervention. That is the final goal of architecture, a nuanced intervention, an intervention based on understanding. So you can't detach the two, but you can't restrict yourself to that. And then you have a disciplinary silo, which is, I think, then architecture is something completely different. So this would be my, so let me say critique, but critique in a positive way, that students working on this, I think the question you should ask yourselves is all those wonderful micro-narratives that you constructed, what do you fold them into? How do you bring them into a kind of positive, speculative, constructive, projective kind of dimension? So then, therefore, the question becomes, how does an architect construct the appropriate narratives for the production of the built environment? So the idea of the context is something that we have traditionally understood as architects. For us, this has meant the physical context extended by its understanding by the wider parameters such as climate, culture, perhaps a deeper excavation of the site in readings that are embedded in the histories of the place, which is what was wonderful about those micro-narratives, which people had actually, you know, excavated so beautifully and rigorously from the landscape. But what do you do with that? But is this reading broad or productive enough for designers to understand the world they intervene in? My colleague, urban geographer at Harvard University, Neil Brenner, challenged me one day to say, he says, what if you nestle the context in its context, where the employing of the meta-narrative to clarify the context in which the context of our operation is cited is a useful instrument to imagine a precise range of potential interventions for the designer, and I would argue for all design professionals. For it's the space in which design intersects with its broader social, political, economic implications, and the humanities more broadly is where the productive space, in my view, lies. Brenner described these meta-narratives through a range of emergent conditions, narratives that fundamentally challenge our forms of engagement as designers in a rapid geo-economic integration that's occurring on the globe, uneven spatial development, so let's not say inequity, it's uneven spatial development. In fact, it is what results from inequity, etc. So this, I think, taking these sort of broader, taking the context off the context is really the challenge that is looking us in the face, and we are sort of avoiding it by staying within the context and excavating the context deeper and deeper. And from this, of course, comes the question of the urbanization of poverty, the remaking of political identities, new claims of citizenship, both issues that have massive implications on the imagination of the built environment. So, in short, the social sciences, the liberal arts, they will become much better partners for us if we create these intersections, not if we jump from one world to the other as binaries, but rather we create a synthesis. This then squarely leads us to the question of the reconstruction of the state in our neoliberal economy, the notion of simultaneous transitions. A colleague of mine describes it as, we are transitioning out of socialism in India, we are transitioning into a form of capitalism. It doesn't happen overnight. For two or three decades, we are going to be transitioning out of socialism and transitioning into capitalism simultaneously. And in the environment we see around us, that's exactly what's happening. There are aspects of our protocols which are about socialist behavior, and there are aspects of our protocols which are about hardcore capitalism, in fact, brutal capitalism, and it's happening simultaneously. Massive implications on the built environment, which we have to deal with. This is the challenge for us as architects. In fact, this also leads us to the question of the role of the state in planning and design, and it intersects then with what is the role of NGOs, civil society, etc. Because we again live in one of those other worlds. We've become architects who work with NGOs, and we are very comfortable in that space. But this is, these partnerships is what will actually change the environment. So it's precisely from this reading that you get an intersection between the context and the context of the context, the sensual and the political. As well, perhaps it is from this intersection that design and societal culture is formed. Again, put in another way, this is also where occur the potential potent intersections between the spheres of our concern with that of the spheres of our direct influence. We chat with each other about our spheres of concern, but the sphere of our interventions is something else. We can't bring them together. So at dinner parties, we are engaged with poverty, we are engaged with transforming the world, but then when we go to our offices the next day, I mean, we are in another world trying to intervene. How do you bring these two worlds together? How do you nourish them? How do you clarify them? So what the articulations of these narratives does in my mind, or makes evident, is the narrow circumscription of our site of operation as architects in this business as usual model of practice. And how, by understanding the site as a mediated kind of place through and also embedded within a larger scale of economic, political, and social processes, can give us, I believe, an opportunity to have a broader socially and progressive impact as designers beyond the site of our project. So for us, it's the architecture of practice is as important as the practice of architecture. What is the structure within which we practice? So I'm going to spend a minute on that and then actually show you, at least share with you what our firm, RMA Architects, has tried to do in engaging with this. So, of course, the one set of models of practice which we all admire, which I would love to spend all my time doing, is, you know, as an advocate with advocacy people, with NGOs, self-initiating some small-scale interventions, research, of course, that's wonderful, and alternative practices all the way, I mean, the Laurie Baker, barefoot architect kind of model, people who engage with absolutely relevant materials. I mean, we had Chitra Vishwanath here, who was, I think, a pioneer in that sort of model, at least in my view. I mean, I think that is the space of respect, at least as far as I go. And I think that then gets recognized, I think, in interesting ways, especially among our peers, among NGOs, among civil society to some extent. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have boutique homes, you have private residences, you have what I call the architecture of indulgence. It's about 1%. It's like for the top 1% around the world. This is what is usually celebrated in the Western architectural press. This is what, you know, wins people awards. This is what we sort of look at. And so we tend to live in one of these worlds. Usually these worlds don't meet, at least in my experience and research, people I've met, they live in one of these other worlds and they look kind of disdainfully at each other. And there are reasons for that, because in that world on the top, form and aesthetics is in the making. It's the process. It's the protocols. The aesthetic is clumsy, but it's clumsy because it's in formation. In the bottom one, it's an aestheticization of modernism, of modernity, but with no social agenda whatsoever. It's sophisticated aesthetically, but in a highly distilled form and therefore detached. I mean, we are all part of it. I live in both these worlds and enjoy them both. But it is the 1%, unfortunately. The most important thing that we ignore is the mainstream. We look at the mainstream disdainfully. And you know, as architects, if we have to be relevant in society, we have to swim in the mainstream. And we have to make what we see on the top and bottom the mainstream. We have created these silos of practice, at least in the way we talk about it in the press, the way we recognize it through awarding, the way we, among our peers, look at it disdainfully or not. So the mainstream, which has institutions, which has developers, so you have very impatient capital, you have patient capital, you have the government where it's lethargic capital, and then now you also have faith-based practices, which are big clients, and my research has shown that the biggest projects in India are not the infrastructure projects, they're the projects that faith-based practices are doing for temple complexes with deep social agendas, and so one has to look at all of that. Those don't even come into the view of us as practitioners, because they have so far employed ancient imagery, which they have employed because they don't have architects trying to interpret contemporary imagery for them, I believe. So, I mean, there's a whole landscape there. So we have to recognize that. Now, the interesting thing is that in each one of these, the protocols and processes are different. The client has a different culture that they come from. The constituencies you create are different. In some cases, it's a single client you deal with and single decision making. Sometimes it's big committees. So the protocols are completely different. And so these, I think, I believe one must recognize, and I think this is a global phenomena, to understand where we are even situated in terms of our protocols and our processes. So with that, I want to sort of first talk about self-initiated research. A lot of us are involved in research, and I think it can also become a silo in itself. I mean, we've been involved in a number of sort of production of a number of books, both in the firm and for myself individually. Many of them have just been tools for advocacy. They don't even pretend to be scholarship in the pure sense. They are to lobby for awareness, to create a heritage legislation, to get improvement, to save a building. They are instruments for advocacy. So research, if you call it action research, let's say, how do you move beyond criticality, which is where we often get stuck, to be propositional, to also be able to act? And so the formulation of research is linked to that, because there are research cultures which must be totally respected if you're doing a PhD or if you're an academic, but research also is an instrument for action. And therefore, action research, the difference is that in action research, you situate yourself in the research, and the research has to become important for you to act. And that's why, again, I refer back to the micro-narratives and the wonderful workshops. I think the students have to imagine that research, those micro narratives you've created where you're placed, you were all placed within that micro narrative, but how does it become a tool for action and becomes instrumental in that way? And so action research is very important, and we were involved in a number of these things, which led to heritage legislation. This was the first heritage legislation in 1995 in Mumbai, as a result of which our historic district got declared a heritage zone. And of course, the means of action were different. We were writing newspaper, I mean, this was an editorial we did in the Times of India, saying that this district was becoming an art district. We constructed a significance for it to save it in a way to create. So the constituency was different. So like politicians have constituencies, I suppose as our advocates and architects, we have to do that. A festival was invented to raise money. The area then was restored in terms of the building through the money generated from the festival. It also created contemporary projects. This is a visitor center that our firm did, which was in stainless steel as a contemporary intervention which respected scale, etc. It became a gateway to the museum. And it made us question, what does conservation mean? Because another kind of disciplinary practice, let's say, that's being fetishized is preservation and conservation. And it's interesting, I came across Rem Koolhaas's chart here, which is fascinating, where he said that, you know, in 1882, where the first act to preserve buildings was instituted, they had listed things from 200 BC. So the gap between the institution of the act and the object that they were conserving was massive. By 1900, when the act was revised, they were already looking at buildings from 1712. So that gap had actually closed. So by the 1960 revision, 20th century and modern architecture was being looked at. So the gap had become 20 years. So therefore, the gap will now close logically. I mean, you know, things sometimes work with these logics, which means that I think what's going to happen is we're going to have to decide beforehand what we are going to preserve. So when we go for sanctions, the government will tick, okay, this building will be worthy to preserve, so build it in better materials, and it'll be on the list before it's built, if you use this logic. And therefore, then, as Rem Koolhaas said, we can invest ourselves more in long-term lasting construction and have fun with short-term buildings. We could imagine buildings for 10 years, for 15 years, because we can't predict more than that. So it's an interesting question for preservation, which has become such a delicate, precious, you know, and I do a lot of conservation work, I have a lot of conservation friends, so I understand it from the inside, but it's become so siloed and precious in what it does, because conservation or preservation is merely a planning tool. So we have to make projective preservation, which is what planning is all about. And so essentially, we need planning. We need to nuance planning much more. We can't have just modernist planning, but we need to nuance it. And in our cities, it goes further. In our cities, architecture is not even the spectacle of the city. This is the Ganesh Festival in Mumbai, which is probably the biggest spectacle of Mumbai. No one remembers architecture, but we remember these icons. And here, this does not even leave a trace of the memory of the city, because when this clay idol dissolves in the water, the memory of the city disappears. The memory of the city is an enacted process. It's kinetic. It's not permanent, and it's not static. Our cities are about elasticity. They're about incrementalism. They're about appropriation. They're about creating soft thresholds. We have transgressions that occur in our cities. And again, those wonderful workshops, the micro-narratives, all captured that so beautifully. But again, I think the question or my critique would be, how do we take that kind of research and construct a vocabulary that's productive for us to intervene as designers, rather than a vocabulary that actually appeals to the other social sciences and not to architects and planners? Ours is a city that's built in stages of squatting. These are the 5 stages of squatting. Over 1 year, this guy makes his permanent thing, but very, very slowly, so nobody notices him. The whole city works like that. Our city is elastic. This is a public space in Mumbai where during the festival it becomes a community center for 10 days during the Ganesh festival. Movies are shown, people have dinner, and after 10 days it disappears and the street goes back to normal. Or because of the density, and that's Mumbai to scale, Mumbai has less green space than even Tokyo, if that's all to scale. And you can even see the difference between Delhi and Mumbai. It's appalling. It's fractured. That's New York and Mumbai at the same scale. It's completely fractured. So here are these cricket pitches. Are wonderful places for cricket, and then they become venues for wedding in the evening. The cricket pitch no one touches because it's sacred, but the club members have samosas and tea from the same kitchen that serves the wedding. And in the morning it disappears and the cricketers are back there. So at the micro scale, there are these narratives you can construct, but you have to construct a vocabulary that makes it productive. You can zoom out and you can look at the meta scale, and how do you make this connection? And that's an interesting question. So this is one reading of cities in India, where you have these, you know, 400 or something cities. But then you look at the census, and you look at this data of the census, and they have recognized about 8,000 towns or cities, which will have municipalities and all of that. But if you take that data and you break it down, and you just say all places with 5,000 people, then you begin to have about 30,000 places in India. No, and they can, I mean, European towns are 5,000 people sometimes. And so you don't recognize this, which means that more than, 60% of our towns are outside our radar because the census doesn't take it up. Then the question from that becomes, what is the appropriate planning, urban design, and architecture for these places? Because what is happening in India is also the tyranny of images. Because the images from Ahmedabad, from Mumbai, from Delhi, from Gurgaon, get transported to cities of or towns of 10,000 people, 20,000 people. So there's a tyranny of imagery which we have to be careful of. So we need a spectrum of planning approaches, a spectrum of form imaginations, a spectrum of densities, a spectrum of architecture to deal with it. Our new research is actually looking at ephemeral urbanism in the light of what the Coolhouse Court said, is how do you even create cities for shorter periods of time where they can be dismantled or expanded with more permanent things. We're creating a taxonomy that's looking at religion, celebration. This is a whole area of research because we take permanence as a default condition. We are taught to do things permanently. When we do studios, we are doing houses, even a weekend house, we are designing as if it's going to be permanent. We've designed this library like it's going to be permanent. So we have to even ask ourselves a question: for how long are we doing architecture? For what? And what are the cycles? How does time become part of this? And one of the studies we did in detail was the Kumbh Mela, where a whole city is built like this, with this sort of rigor, where from flooded waters emerges a city in just merely 8 weeks, a megacity is built. Now, talk about the micro-narratives in this megacity, it's absolutely mind-boggling. And then it sits on the sand of the banks when the water removes, and then it gets flooded and it disappears. So from that mega, let's roll back now to the micro. Weathering, climate, the context. Now let's talk about the context we are excited about, because this is the broader context that we have to keep thinking about when we are designing within the context of our climate. How we go down to details which look at weather. How do we recognize that there has been a massive shift in our culture as architects from weathering to weatherproofing? We used to worry about weathering. Now we are looking at alcobond, we're looking at sealants, we're looking at building materials that have lives for 200 years. That don't weather. And so this is, again, a complete difference. It has an implication on money, it has an implication on time, it has an implication on our culture. Conservation becomes important. What I learned from conservation is how time can be embedded in our imagination, how the life cycle of materials is different. So when you combine two materials of different life cycles in a building, in conservation architects always deal with problems where materials of two life cycles meet each other because one gives way before the other. But if you separate them through design, that's how you embed. So for me, conservation is an instrument of architecture, it's an instrument of planning. It's not another silo, and we've got to stop constructing these silos. When you work with private and individual clients, I think it's one gamut of issues. How do you bring the context of the context there? How do you sensitize yourself and your clients then to the question of society and politics? This is Mumbai. People build houses in Alibag and for weekends. I always give this example of a wonderful house that I happened to meet the contractor on the boat going there and asked him, who's the architect of this house you're designing, when he showed me these images. And he said, no, I'm designing it. My client just gave me a picture of the White House in Washington and asked me to copy it. And so that's how the rich begin to build in these areas. The architecture itself creates a polarization of society. Beware of dog signs, electric wires, big gates, etc. How do you not do that? So this was a house that we did where it was for a young couple, and we convinced them that the living room should be an open porch because they're hardly there for maybe 20 days in the year. So the caretaker and his family actually use the porch, which is the living room, when the clients are not using the weekend house. And when they're there, in any case, they want to hang out on the porch. There are taps there, the roofs collect water, the well is charged, and anyone from the village can come and take water from the well. It is not to say you compromise the articulation of the architecture. You keep that integrity, but you can embed these social aspirations. They might be idealistic, but at least if we begin to discuss them, we'll nuance our architecture more. And of course, there are many other such lessons embedded here, which I will not describe. Or a house for a doctor we did, which was close to a village, and we kind of fragmented it in terms of form, and we looked at how it can be incremental too, which means although this was a wealthy doctor, the house was designed that it could be used as a model even for a middle-class person, where they could add each room without spoiling the integrity of the house, and how it could be discrete, where functions which are not compatible with the rural landscape in which it sits, like a swimming pool, which is hedonism, etc., gets embedded in kind of private areas within the house, and of course, in terms of scale, how it begins to relate to it. And this is the insides of the house. They're rather simple materials. The pool is very discreet with a study and a guest room, and it gets glimpses of the landscape, but it's not in your face because they're poorer villagers who live around here, and it unfolds as spaces. It has a lot of flexibility where rooms can be combined. It has porosity and ambiguity. So all the wonderful things that you'd like to do in architecture. Then you move to private corporations. The sale, because patronage becomes very important. The complexity of the patron is incredibly critical. So this was a private client for an office building in Hyderabad. A dry climate. It's in high-tech city in Hyderabad. The circular building you see is Mario Botta's building. And we were given this site, and it's our infrastructure company that builds highways. They have cameras on all the equipment. They have this NASA-like room from where they monitor everything, and they wanted a glass box, naturally. So we started looking at all the glass boxes in Hyderabad, Mercedes-Benz showrooms and all of this, and we found that because the state was being split into Telangana, these were great targets for riots. People used to throw stones. So the curtain glazing manufacturers, when they were selling glass, they also gave you a choice of fishing nets, the color of fishing nets to match the glass, and they did all your detailing for you so that the glass buildings could stay, but the fishing nets could protect it. It was interesting that when we discussed this, we thought, these are very powerful images, obviously, if people are doing this in spite of it being stoned. So we were, of course, uncomfortable. At that time, we were doing a project in Jaipur, which I'll show you, and we started noticing these huts. Can we have the sound? So we began to see, this is a water cooler, which a community association puts up with the help of the government, and this guy works for the government, and he puts his little kettle out for water, and people come and drink water. There are no paper cups, there are no plastic cups. He just puts his hand, he says hello and thank you, and he drinks water. It's as sustainable, if you want to use that word, which is also problematic, but it's at least eco-friendly, very small footprint. And every now and then he comes out and he wets the thing. So it's like the cuss which we used with water coolers. This thing stays very cool. And then there are earthen pots in it, which also through evaporative cooling keeps the water very cool. So this is it's a no-brainer. It's the simplest little piece of architecture. The primitive hut, I mean, in Western theory, you call it the primitive hut, perhaps. And then it's such a beautiful experience. It's social. So we said we will use this. It's okay. We will use this. It's okay. We will use this as the model for our building because it had a human touch to it. And we said, how does one create empathy for the poorest in the building by creating architecture? And can architecture play that role? So we came up with a project where we did a 5-foot floor high garden, but it's not a green wall where you stick the garden on the wall like, you know, people do. But this is a screen which is kept cool with water and cools the building. And every facade is different depending on the direction. The kind of plants that grow there are different. So we experimented in the nursery. And talk about impatient capital, they wanted the building in 14 months. We gave them the building and took permission to grow the facade for 2 more years. So we detached the facade and the image of the building from their requirement to begin to generate capital from the building. And the cows came and they inaugurated the building. And outside Hyderabad, in a little shed, was a little factory that was set up to make the trellises. We didn't go to a big company. These were done in a small factory so that we could hire people. And we couldn't afford the mold. So we made only one mold, so it took about 16 months to actually build. And it was all done by labor, but it was new technology. We often fetishize craft with stone and with very traditional crafts. But I mean, how do you bring new materials also in this skill building process was one of the questions we asked ourselves. And so this was the mold because it also has a misting system integrated in it. They're very small panels that are handmade, and then two people can fix it on the facade. So about 15 or 16 people, including women, work here. It's very light, so it's very efficient. It's a mixture of alloys, of aluminium, so you have a very beautiful texture. And when there are enough that are stacked up, two people go and they start erecting it. It gets erected. That's when it was just finished. That's the misting system in it, which keeps the building cool. It's not for the plants. The plants are fed through a hydroponic tray, so it's much more efficient. This is for effect, but to also keep the building sort of cool. And you can sort of generate the intensity of the water based on what you sort of need. And so that's, those are just some images when it was very early. It's about 5 years old now, maybe a little more. But I mean, I think there were many lessons that we learned from the building, one of empathy. But I think the more important lesson was how one could use this sort of green facade in a productive way, not just as an aesthetic. And when it's misting, you get this effect of rain. The presence of the gardeners was very, very important to us. The patterns that were formed with shadows was very important to us. The presence of the plants, of people, it's much, much thicker now. But that's the world outside. So really, it was about, it grows, it becomes a woolly monster. You have to give it a haircut, it goes back, it grows. It's sort of got a podium, which is also social. People meet for lunch. The section is interesting because it also uses convection to take the air out. There are many different species of plants. It creates a very social place because the gardeners are befriended, so people can get bouquets made. People trap butterflies to take for their children, etc. It has a section and an organizational logic, which I won't go into. We never did this scientifically. We did this intuitively. We are now trying to map to see what we can learn from the building. But that's the kind of environment they work in. I'll just hold this slide because this was an intern in our office took this slide. It wasn't posed, but it made us think a lot about this. That woman is wearing her best sari. This is empathy because, you see, the gardeners are the poorest paid in a corporation like that. Usually the garden would be in front. There'd be a glass building. The boss would drive in a tinted car with a glass. They would have no contact, etc. But here, the gardeners are the heroes of the building. The facade and the identity of the building depends on the gardeners, and they can walk free through the building. So this catwalk goes on all 5 floors. They can access it. There's no door that locks it. So they decide where to go. So their bosses have to actually negotiate with them in their own way. And of course, they befriend them. They could put the blind down. There's a blind there. But then you would do that very carefully. So the presence of the poorest in the building is completely inverted in this case, where not only does the identity of the building depend on them, but their presence is like in the heart of the building, literally. And that makes a massive difference. So they are really the heroes of the building, and this is a meeting going on, and they won't put the blind down naturally because it will almost be offensive, which otherwise people would be offensive, but when you bring this proximity, I think it does magic. And it sits as a like this woolly monster in there. So then we go to the last sort of categories, which is institutional. This wonderful place. I was blessed to be asked by Bimal and the SEP board to come and do this. So very intimidating also because these are buildings we grew up with and really very hard to respond to. And of course, I think we treated this as working in a historic context. So we the fact that you know there are 3 floors below the building, but we decided to keep the scale and the quality of the campus. So the building goes very much under the ground, if for those of you who haven't been there. So it's 3 buildings, which are buildings within buildings. And what you see, this is, of course, an older rendering. And it opens, so you get a kind of porosity. You have a kind of depth to it with different spaces, a different feeling. This will be when it's finished. It's not finished yet. It's only 75% done. Those are the bookcases, which will be like large walk-in closets. This is the second basement, so this is already 2 floors below the ground. You're going to have a lot of natural light there. Hopefully there will be an ambiance of reading and then reading up, which will be more transparent. But the reason I show this is because it's a whole different project. I mean, I think we had the best clients we could. We were totally blessed. But it's a whole different process in terms of protocols and processes. It's many people. It's not Bimal calling me up and saying, do this, do that. Yes, no. We are dealing with committees. We have many views which have to be synthesized. Luckily, I was a student here, so I know all the skeletons in everybody's cupboard. So sometimes I can pull them out if I have to, try to convince someone. But it's a set of protocols which are different because you have different responsibilities when you're building for an institution. It's money in trust. You have to deliver it. You have to be the guardian of that sort of intention. And of course, this meant many consultations. I mean, it's not easy to present to a group of 200 architects and many students who use social media, where often, like Chinese whispers, it starts out by talking about the articulation of windows and it lands up 30 tweets and, you know, emails later about the best Chinese food in town. So it's kind of confusing set of protocols that you have to synthesize. But this becomes important. In many ways, these are the mainstream. And because of the complexity of the mainstream, we often shy away from it. A more recent project, and these are foundations, where then capital becomes patient. They become gifts. In this case, this is the Lalbhai Museum, which is in Shaibagh, which was about intervening in a historic district. So it was also in a historic compound. So it was about creating an amenity, which in this case we imagined as cultural infrastructure within a historic preservation rubric. And I think these are the kinds of narratives that we have to create, because in my conversations, in this case with the client, it was about seeing and imagining this as cultural infrastructure. How would people come? How would it be used? What is the perception? That narrative of these being cultural infrastructure, so we shouldn't be limited by our physical infrastructure, becomes a narrative, like the micro narratives you guys created about the city. We've got to create new narratives for our projects, because it becomes ways we can reimagine the problem and expand the contribution those spatial arrangements can make for society more broadly. So here, of course, it is about a dialogue with the contemporary and the old. Something from the turn of the last century, which was designed by Claude Backley. How do you begin to talk to that? How does the gallery work? How do you add, in this case, a platform and a handicap ramp to a historic sort of facade? And then these kinds of public spaces, which then become spaces for the public. This is like an art plaza. It would have performances. It might have gathering, poetry reading. It becomes one more amenity for the city. But the imagination of this narrative didn't come in a clear brief, or it didn't come from me to the client in a clear sort of response. It came with much discussion and development. It becomes a role that we play in constructing these narratives. On the other end, when you have faith-based practices, and this is an experience from 2 weeks ago, we literally were here, and within 24 hours, we were here, which was a whole different sort of operation, which is a campus for Virathan, which is a sort of reform movement of Jainism or some sect within it. And it was about a ceremony. It was about sanctifying the land. That is the land and the site. And this was a very elaborate ceremony as part of the first presentation. This was our first presentation, which was to 600 or 700 people, including the Acharya, including Murari Bapu, who also came for it. It's a campus for young sadhuis from the rural areas who will be trained to become monks, to live there with many other amenities that are going to be practiced. That's Murari Bapu and the Acharyaji. These are the ceremonies. This is all part of our first sort of interaction on design. This is where we had to present our design to this constituency within a protocol and a set of protocols set up by them. It's a completely different imagination. The constituency is different. The people who donate to it to raise the money are different. It becomes part of the role of society. Then with civil society and NGO sectors, it's completely different. Sanitation is a big problem. This is Dharavi. I mean, I always talk about the slide I took accidentally, but when I went and downloaded and I saw that boy, it was amazing. It moved me, because this boy is wearing a white shirt, white socks, and he's going to school. But I realized that he defecated in the open. He doesn't have a toilet. So he went out, defecated, changed, and he went. He looks completely intact. What are we doing about this? Look at the statistics in Mumbai. One toilet for 1,440 people. You know, the NGO we worked with, Spark, said 1:800. The Bombay Municipal Corporation says 1:50. Their target ratio is 1:50. They say 150, their target ratio is 1:50, which means 6 families will share a toilet, which means every morning you'll have to have a lottery, or you'll have to say that every 3 weeks, one person from those 6 families uses the toilet. So even as an aspiration, it's terrible. So our Prime Minister is going, of course, in the right direction. That map shows you defecation levels. India in the world, we, you know, think of Africa as being underdeveloped. India is the highest open defecation in the world by far. I mean, we have a premium on this problem, you know, in an extreme sense. And Mr. Modi has said by 2019. But this is not possible, because this is the imagination of the toilets by 2019. Could you have a toilet like this, like on your way to home, there's a toilet that's left there for you to use? This requires design imagination, which is completely different, which is, I think, a reflection on our profession. Can you solve that problem? Impossible. Can you have a single toilet for each of those houses? Impossible. So what are we talking about? We are thinking about absolutes. We have to look at how we make this transition. So what is happening is they're making a million toilets and leaving it outside people's homes. People are storing wheat and rice in it because it's a room you can lock. No one is using it as a toilet. Some people are, but not that many. So we have to make these transitions before we can have a transformation. It's a different imagination of the role of the architect of design. So community toilets is a way, because you make the transition, at least in some conditions. But community toilets have a problem because they become associated as sanitation places that no one goes there. So we began to get involved in trying to reimagine this. How could you stack toilets? How could you put a caretaker's house on the top and create a community center? Could you put it on solar panel and get it off the grid? So we did a number of them, and the politics of this is a lecture in itself, but we were stopped by the government. They thought it was too iconic. They thought if the slum dwellers got together and organized themselves in the community center, they would stop the developer from redeveloping the slum. It's a whole lecture in itself. But we managed to pull one off, and we built it. It became a community center for the children. We put solar panels, which we got donations from. The public housing there, they haven't moved into for 12 years because it's so badly designed. And so it just proves the point that you need these transitions. And it got done. It sits there. It's iconic. But it completely failed. And it failed, and I was listening to people in this micro-narratives yesterday. It failed because we didn't structure the participatory dimension of it well enough. The NGO there wasn't embedded in that community. There were many, many problems which I get. But I mean, I think these are wicked problems. And the NGO, when they approached us, they told us an engineer was doing it because all the young architects they asked weren't doing it. And of course, these young architects were smarter than me because they knew it's a wicked problem and it was going to fail. We took it on because we thought we would give it a shot. And so, ever tried, ever failed, no matter, try again, fail better. So I think failure, if orchestrated in our minds as a productive process, should be part of these micro-narratives that we construct. Because through these interventions in wicked problems, I think there is an amazing amount of intelligence that we can gather. We didn't give up. We tried. We entered a competition for the Gates Foundation. It was an international competition. We won the first prize. We did a toilet that could be dismantled completely because the last toilet would World Bank specs. We embedded it in the community even more. We came up with the idea of making it a sanitation center where sachets of soap could be sold, filtered water could be sold. We were then thinking that you could have a laundromat in it because water could be used efficiently for a very small price. People could come and wash their clothes because often in the slums you don't even have those amenities. Then it becomes a sanitation center. It's not a public toilet. This failed for many other reasons because the architects in Delhi who were coordinating this, before the competition results were announced, they appointed a contractor to do 500 toilets based on their design. So the whole thing, again, we failed. So we'll try again. We think our aspiration is if the toilet or the sanitation center can be in front of the temple, we would have really succeeded. Governments is a whole different thing, and I'll just show you this project and I'll end. It's a completely different animal. My friend Bimal here will tell you many more stories, more authoritatively about this. He's dealt with them head on many things, as you all know. But we did a small project, which again had many failures and I think now successes. And it's for 100 elephants and their mahouts. And these mahouts are all Muslims, so they're also a minority group there, which in that political condition of Rajasthan is something you have to reckon with. Elephants came there by mistake. They were bought for pomp. They don't have to be in deserts. They're tropical beings. But they take tourists up. They get painted. There's no water. Their skin's color. They go rogue. They attack tourists. The government had them living there, like a car garage and the people living on top. It was a competition. We won the competition. We got a land, which was a site that was given to us. We very quickly recognized that this is a landscape problem. So we got a good consultant and we worked on it as a landscape project because we said, forget the architecture. If you have water, you'll have a successful project. You'll have life. How do you create this imagination of infrastructure which can let life sort of thrive? And on that site, there were some buildings that were broken there in the middle, which I'll show you in a second. And we came up with this project with our landscape consultant, Mohan Rao. In fact, this morning, it was announced that he won the Hutko Award for urban design for his ideas for Hathigaon. So he just won that award this morning because it's a very lovely scheme of micro dams and a whole landscape scheme. And we got the site in 2007, and that hill is the same hill there. In 3 years, by just putting micro dams, we actually trapped the water. And we had metrics which said there were enough water for 100 elephants, even through the summer. And I've gone there in the first 2-3 years in July, and there was enough water. Of course, we looked at the architecture. The client wanted row houses. We convinced them to do clusters. And there were many sort of things involved here. Elephants can't sleep on flat land, so we used to do mock-ups to see what sizes elephants need. It was a lot of fun because even elephants come in small, medium, large, and extra large. So we had to sort of have a whole range of elephant rooms for that. And that's what it looked like. These were roofs designed to keep the thatch for the food, and it would also create insulation. And that's what it began to look like. Different clusters. It's a low cost. The Mahouts earn 5,000 rupees, $100 a month. So they're among the poorest sort of paid. But because of the water, some parts began to flourish. And of course, this was a political problem. So the government that had appointed us, when they fell out of power, for 6 or 7 years, the project was abandoned. So the government didn't look after it. It became like an informal city. It is like that. I was there yesterday. There's no sanitation. So now the government, the new government, the present government under Vasundhara Raje, who had appointed us, has made a promise to finish this by July and were apologetic that they had ignored it. And so we've had, in 1 month, 3 meetings with 20 engineers at each meeting, and they're going to finish this by July because they know the bones are right. But the trees grew in the meantime because it was ignored. Life corrodes architecture. In housing, life always corrodes architecture. The goats have come. The trees have grown. The dish antennas have arrived in some parts. And of course, there are many schemes now which we will implement. This is how it used to be 4 or 5 years ago, but it's not been cared off. But the kikar has grown. The landscape, there wasn't a tree on site. I think some of you went there the other day. And now all the trees you see on site have been grown in the last 5 or 6 days. Some parts where the water collects, it's much dense. Elephants are social beings. They have to hang out together. So we're going to be meaning. We are going to be, I'm going to take 2 more minutes. We're going to be making many more of these pavilions. But you know, we made these pavilions and an interesting thing happened. The Mahout's children are teenagers. So they started a company called Elephantastic, and they have a website, and you can book a time, and you go there, you pay them 300 rupees to take a picture, you pay them 500 rupees, and they'll take you for a bath with the elephant. So there's a whole economy that is developing there. And the lesson from that is, I don't take credit for this, this was totally accidental. We were trying to create robust infrastructure in an ecological way, which again, I think yesterday, one compliment that I would have for the micro-narratives is y'all were all thinking ecologically, how things were interlinked. And by thinking like that, life flourishes because many things and which are unintended begin to occur because the armature for this exists. So there's an economy that has developed now just because of this sort of accident. And now there are elephant experts getting involved as of last week that are going to advise us on many, many other things. This is what happened when the government abandoned the project because people didn't have the capacity to do it. But the bones of the project are very good. The infrastructure is there. And I'm confident after this next monsoon, it'll come back to what I showed you. This was a meeting of 24 hours ago where we had our first, and there are no women ever present in these meetings in Rajasthan. It's always a lot of men. And so you are dealing, this is the client base. I have to actually satisfy almost everyone because they're all from different departments that have a say in this sort of process. And now there's another generation, an NGO has started a school there and their children, and life will flourish because I think the bones and the infrastructure is very good. I'm just going to conclude by saying that as the world becomes increasingly global, I think we have to be, everything happening in the world today, we have to be cautious about accepting that things are growing more alike because they begin to look more alike. We have to be very careful about that. When they begin to look more alike, it doesn't mean that they're similar. Because when we engage with a deeper excavation on the site on which we operate, it's an understanding that draws both from objective reality as well as subjective perception. The micro-narratives that you all were talking about yesterday off the site, the differences actually emerge much, much more strikingly than before, where differences were actually assured when things were looking different. So this is something we as designers have to be very, very careful about. So architects will have to find more rigorous ways of defining the complex, emerging cultural fabric of multiple aspirations in the landscape of places like India, our mutinous democracy, but even the United States, Europe, I think diversity. These are issues that you all are dealing with. But more importantly, we have to see this cultural fabric as an ever-evolving landscape, not as a found category. The one mistake we make is we see culture as a found category. We see identity as a found category. We don't discover our identity. We construct our identity. And that's where architecture becomes instrumental. In the words of Arjun Appudarai, culture is a dialogue between aspirations and sedimented traditions. So in these interpretations that we as designers make of a place or culture, ideas of the future, our speculations of the future, are as important as those about the past. And they have to necessarily be embedded and drive our imaginations of this future. An identity gets constructed in the process of us putting value on what those aspirations are, not looking retrospectively back. So it's the simultaneity of these gestures that are very important. And design can play a critical role in dissolving these binaries rather than allowing one entity to prevail and remake the city in its broader image. Today, difference is in your face. It's not abstract, whether it's Europe or the United States or India. It's not distant, it's very close. In a pluralistic society, a pluralistic society is one that actually accepts those differences, but goes beyond to understand and even be influenced and transformed by those differences in productive ways. That is to see the simultaneous validity of these differences. Because once the architect sees these various differences as being simultaneously valid, the challenge is, how do you go beyond these polarized binaries? How do you make your research instrumental? How do you make your research action-oriented? How do you deal with the different worlds, different adjacencies? How do you bring different scales together in the city? How do you imagine transitions as well as things that have to be permanent? How do you bring time to the imagination of space? This is the agency of architecture. This is where architecture planning becomes critical instruments to inform spatial possibilities for society. Possibilities that make society and our cities humane and equitable. And I believe when we do this, we will become instrumental as architects and planners, and we'll engage with technology, the built environment. But most importantly, I think we'll actually serve society in more meaningful ways. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rahul.